The flawed battle plan for the Great Somme Offensive of July 1916 doomed a generation of young men. The British troops who went over the top that day faced a struggle uphill in full pack against German guns that should have been silenced by an enormous artillery barrage. Those men fortunate enough to make it to the German lines were horrified to look back and see how overlooked their positions had been. To make matters worse, the failed tactics that destroyed an army were repeated time and again. Those who sent Kitchener's army into the line of fire on July the 1st, 1916, had paved the way for the British Army's greatest military disaster.
There were approximately 60,000 British casualties at the end of the first day. We're talking about 40,000 wounded in these trenches, another 20,000 dead.
By the time the Battle of the Somme ended on the 24th of November, 1.2 million people had been killed or wounded on both sides.
The landscape around these lovely French towns and villages looks as beautiful today as it must have done in the summer of 1916. During that long, hot summer of the Great War, hundreds of thousands of young British troops marched through these peaceful lanes, ready to make the big push against the Germans. Singing the innocent songs of a generation, many of them plucked one of the plentiful poppies that lined the green lanes and cheerfully stuck them in their uniforms. The poppy of the Somme would become their everlasting emblem. Even though these momentous events took place more than 80 years ago, the scars on the French landscape are still visible today. They are enduring reminders of the shells of 1916. Although millions were fired into the German trenches during the opening phase of the Battle of the Somme, most fell with little effect. This was just one part of a British strategy for the battle that would go horribly and tragically wrong. As it turned out, the opening day of the Battle of the Somme was fought on the middle day of the middle year of World War I. By this time, a position of stalemate had been reached by the opposing sides, for along the whole front, from the North Sea to the Swiss frontier, little or no progress was being made, as the men of all armies dug themselves deep into trenches to defend their positions.
The position on the Western Front strategically by the summer of 1916 was stalemate, trench deadlock. But the Allies had decided at the Chantilly Conference in December 1915 to advance on three fronts during 1916 to push the Russians into East Prussia, to have the Italians attack on the Isonzo, and have a Franco-British attack on the Somme.
Now, of course, what happened is that the Anglo-French plans were preempted by Falkenhayn's attack at Verdun, which started at the beginning of February 1916.
It was here, during one of the most notorious battles of the entire war, that German and French forces pounded each other into a bloody stalemate. The French generals had famously pledged to defend Verdun to the last drop of blood. This they did, but France's fighting spirit was all but crushed, and her armies were brought to the brink of mutiny. 315,000 Frenchmen were killed or wounded during the battle, which also claimed 280,000 German lives. Verdun certainly earned its chilling nickname, the Mincer. During the early months of 1916, the British had at least one eye on the need to ease the pressure on the French troops fighting at Verdun. Under pressure from French High Command to act, General Sir Douglas Haig, the commander of the British forces, had agreed to open the 1916 offensive, and he chose the Valley of the Somme in the Picardy region of northern France as the place to strike.
The Battle of Verdun had a very great impact on the Battle of the Somme. We've got to remember that the Battle of the Somme was meant to be a Franco-British advance. But, of course, with the Germans having attacked the French at Verdun, it was very difficult for the French to supply the resources required for this massive Allied attack in France on the Somme. And so what we see is Verdun, if you like, sapping Allied resources.
It would fall to the British to provide the bulk of the troops for the major summer push that everyone hoped would signal a turning point in the fortunes of the Allies. Sadly, the old British Regular Army, the famous Old Contemptibles of the BEF, had been destroyed by 2 years of inconclusive fighting in earlier battles. The men who marched to the Western Front in 1916 were therefore almost exclusively new volunteers. They were Kitchener's Army, named after the Minister for War, Lord Kitchener, whose vigorous recruitment campaign had attracted almost 500,000 ordinary men to the colours. These men of the new army were raw and inexperienced, but they were eager, bursting full of patriotism, ready to do their duty for king and country.
Kitchener's army were raised in late 1914. There was a massive thrust of enthusiasm within England that everybody wanted to get forward, get into this major adventure that was going to happen in Europe.
The menfolk of entire towns and villages had joined up, forming the famous Pals or Chums battalions, in which the whole population of an area served together in the same unit.
Kitchener's army spanned the entire age range of British male society, from people in their early teens to men well beyond the age of retirement.
The officer corps was largely drawn from ex-public schoolboys, and the ranks were filled with the working classes, or those middle classes that hadn't gone to public school. They were shaped quite quickly in initial training, but really the sheer numbers of Kitchener's army meant that it was quite difficult administratively to train them, feed them, billet them, and then move them out to the Western Front. However, by May 1916, the vast majority were on the Western Front, and of course the Battle of the Somme was where they cut their fighting teeth.
Before the Somme, the war was still popular, viewed by those who joined up as a magnificent interlude from the toil and hardships of everyday life. A war to be heroically fought and, of course, gloriously won. But whatever their background or rank, none of these patriotic volunteers could possibly have prepared themselves for the nightmare of violence and slaughter that awaited them. In preparation for the assault, the British artillery planned to bombard the German trenches mercilessly for 5 days and nights. Prevailing military logic held that such a bombardment would reduce the German trenches to rubble and destroy the long, deadly belts of barbed wire that protected the German lines.
Artillery conquers, infantry occupies. The plan was that artillery would destroy the Germans who defended the trench system, and once the Germans were all dead or shell-shocked or pounded into pieces, then the British infantry, or the French infantry, would just walk across no man's land, occupy the trenches, take anybody prisoner who happened to be left alive, let the German burial parties bury their dead, and carry on into the green fields beyond.
In time, it would become tragically apparent that the theory did not match the reality.
The barrage was going to be a five-day barrage. It was going to involve 2,000 guns. Now, that sounds like a lot, but remember they're spread over some 18 miles of front, and only 200 of them are actually what we today would call heavy guns. 1,800 of them were actually 18-pounders, and they were firing shrapnel. So they were not very effective against German forces in bunkers or in deep trench systems.
And a lot of the shells are being made by inexpert munitions workers. A lot of the good munitions workers went out and volunteered on day one, remember? And they're all off in the trenches or dead. So a lot of the people who are filling shells back home are not really experts at making an artillery round. So fully one-third of British artillery rounds fired at the Somme were duds.
There were also some other ideas for softening up the enemy ahead of the Somme attack. During the month of June, for example, miners from Scotland and Yorkshire had tunneled beneath No Man's Land to plant 7 huge mines under the German trenches. These were to be detonated before the main attack. British forces began the feverish preparation for the Battle of the Somme by accumulating almost 3 million rounds of artillery ammunition behind their lines. The scale of the operation was unprecedented. Each day of the barrage, some 250,000 shells would be fired into the German lines. By contrast, the Emperor Napoleon had only 20,000 rounds at his disposal for the entire Battle of Waterloo, fought 100 years earlier. This huge logistical effort was, however, impossible to disguise from the enemy. Unwittingly, the British were sending the clearest possible signal that a major offensive was imminent, giving the German forces weeks in which to fortify and strengthen their positions. Nevertheless, Sir Douglas Haig and his generals believed that they had devised the most foolproof master plan of this or any other war.
The British Army in the late 19th and early 20th century, when Douglas Haig came up, did not promote people to general because they were military geniuses. And as a result, a fellow like Douglas Haig was not the sharpest knife in the British Army's drawer.
Haig was quite unexceptional in all sorts of ways. He was like every other cavalry general. He believed in breakthrough, he believed in maneuver, and he hadn't mentally adjusted to the conditions of the Western Front. Cavalry generals who actually believed in maneuver were really out of their depth.
I believe that he was a man under great pressure. And whilst he was trying to fend off that pressure, Joffre and the French government and the politicians particularly were trying very desperately to draw us into this battle much quicker than we really wanted to be. And although we had a very large army, they were very undertrained. And so Haig was balancing one against the other.
For 2 years, the bloody stalemate of trench warfare had prevailed. Now the Allies believed this great breakthrough would get their troops moving and re-establish the longed-for war of mobility. Supremely confident in their strategy and judgment, the British generals believed that every possible eventuality for the coming assault had been considered. Haig had entrusted the main thrust of the attack to the new 4th Army under General Sir Henry Rawlinson. At 52 years of age, Rawlinson was a highly experienced infantryman who had fought in the Boer War and had seen action in Burma. He was to be a central figure in the coming battle. The 4th Army was ordered to seize the German positions on the Pozières Ridge on a 10-mile front from Montauban, its most southerly point, to the River Ancre in the north.
Tomlinson understood almost instinctively after the battles of 1915 and early 1916 that what was required was a new means of fighting, and that was to attack into the German trench system but not try and attack through. And Rawlinson pioneered what was going to be called the bite and hold technique, so that you don't attack beyond what your artillery can cover.
Now, when Haig saw his plan, he said that this wasn't what he wanted. He wanted a much deeper preliminary bombardment, more than doubling the targets, therefore, that Rawlinson had planned. And this, of course, diluted the artillery and had a massive impact, actually, upon the success of the bombardment that actually took place for 8 days prior to the 1st of July.
And so what happens is that Fourth Army's commander, Rawlinson, has imposed on him a plan for a breakthrough, with which he is in fundamental disagreement.
The ever-optimistic Haig had even ordered the bringing up of three new cavalry divisions, commanded by Lieutenant General Sir Hubert Gough, who were to exploit any gaps in the German lines achieved by Rawlinson's Fourth Army and push on into the open ground beyond the enemy positions. Haig sensed that this may be his beloved cavalry's last opportunity to play a major role in battle, and he did not intend to see the chance wasted. To ensure the Fourth Army had the best chance of success, Haig ordered a simultaneous diversionary attack by the Third Army at the extreme northern end of the British lines. To these men fell the task of assaulting Gommecourt, a well-defended German-held village. The plan here provided for an attack by the 46th North Midland Division to the north of the British line and the 56th London Division to the south, with the objective being to link up behind the German positions, thereby cutting off the garrison there. The assault here, therefore, had the dual responsibility of taking the salient and creating a diversion for the major attack taking place in the south.
The diversionary attack at Gommecourt aimed to divert valuable German resources, especially guns and troops, away from the area that was meant to be broken through and through which the cavalry would have exploited. And right up there on the northern edge of the Somme battlefield, two divisions of Allenby's Third Army were meant to make as clear as possible to the Germans that they were preparing to attack.
The commander of the Third Army was General Sir Edmund Allenby. He and Sir Douglas Haig cared little for each other, and Allenby was unimpressed by the battle plan. He noted with some consternation that there was to be a 1 mile gap between the Fourth Army to the south and the Third Army's diversionary attack that Allenby was certain would leave his men exposed to German fire on three sides. He therefore concluded that not only would the attack fail to achieve its objective, it also stood little chance of succeeding as a diversion. Allenby communicated his misgivings about the strategy to Haig, but they were simply dismissed. There were also other flaws in the British master plan. The enduring image of the battlefields of the Great War are of desolate, muddy wastelands, but in summer, other than the shell holes which pocked the countryside, the ground between the trenches was often full of verdant green grass with wild flowers. In 1916, as we have seen, the Somme was deemed to be a quiet sector. Although the distance between opposing battle lines varied, in many cases, the entrenched opponents were less than 300 yards apart. At most, they were separated by about half a mile. The entire Somme area offered few strategic advantages for either side, and consequently, the troops in the trenches, which were cut in the chalky soil of the region, adopted a live and let live policy. This inertia was to have grave consequences for the Allies.
The Germans had actually been in possession of the land in this Somme area since late 1914, early 1915. They'd had that period of time to consolidate their defences. Very cleverly, their military planners had looked at the geography of the ground and in most instances had chosen their defensive areas along ridges, along high points, giving their defences every advantage.
The rich chalk soil allowed the Germans to dig to a depth of more than 12 feet. Moreover, they had used the relatively quiet moments to bring in concrete, which had been used to construct dugouts, some of which were 40 feet deep and fitted with electric lights and running water.
The Germans knew they were going to be there for a while. The Germans were holding enemy territory. They had no reason to get out of their trenches and attack into France. So the Germans really settled into their trenches, and they moved beds in and furniture, and they had some nice paneling on the walls sometimes. They moved large stores of food and drink into their trenches, and they were much easier to supply than Allied trenches because they were better connected to the German rail network. And the Germans tried to live as best they could.
The German trenches along the Somme were thus transformed into formidable fortresses that were effectively bomb-proof. In addition to these superb defensive positions, the German lines were also peppered with concrete pillboxes and observation posts. Many still survive and can be seen today.
Now, for 50 yards in front of the forward line of trenches, there was barbed wire. It was a mixture of concertina, of spool barbed wire, and strand barbed wire. 50 yards thick. So attacking British infantry would find the first thing they came up against was 50 yards of barbed wire, and then the first German trench, and then another 400 yards of German trench system before they actually got into open ground.
On the British side, however, no such comforts existed. High Command always believed that trench warfare was a mere pause in what would eventually become a mobile war.
The Allies were supposed to be attacking. The Allies were supposed to be reconquering France, and as a result, the Allies could not admit to themselves they had to settle in for the long haul. So the Allied trenches were always far more slapdash affairs. Even though they lived in these trenches sometimes for years, it would be an admission of giving up the initiative for the Allies to build permanent trench structures.
Unlike their commanders, who were safe behind the lines, the ordinary British troops knew only too well why the Somme was the worst place to launch a major offensive.
Infantry, ideally, if you're going to take them into an attack, want to go in on flat ground or slightly downhill. If you look at the topography of the Somme, in many instances, the German defensive areas were at the top of rises. So consequently, our men had to move uphill in nearly all cases.
What the British could not know was that, from many of the German trenches, it was actually possible to see directly into the shallow British lines.
The British didn't understand how visible they were from the top of the hill. But the fact was that throughout the preparations for the Battle of the Somme, and the preparations for the Battle of the Somme were huge, and the Germans were just sitting up there with binoculars watching it happen. It did not take a brilliant general to know that there was going to be a big attack coming up this hill. And as a result, the Germans were very, very well prepared for the attack on the Somme.
On June the 30th, as the hours ticked away until zero hour, yet another flaw in the British plan was becoming apparent. At first, the inexperienced troops about to go over the top were much encouraged by the ruthless bombardment of the German positions by their artillery. Some British soldiers even began to feel sorry for the Germans as the shells, 1.5 million of them, rained down day and night. According to the carefully prepared British plan, the destruction of the German lines should have been complete by June the 30th. But patrols returning that night brought ominous news. The much-touted barrage upon which so much rested was clearly not doing its job. In later years, a survivor from the British Ulster Division recalled,
"I told an officer what the patrol had seen. The wire was definitely still intact. It was practically uncut by the shelling. The bombardment had caused a lot of big craters, but the wire was still intact."
Reports such as these were put down to pre-battle jitters and were simply ignored by High Command. But the unpalatable truth was plain. The German barbed wire was practically unscathed by the huge bombardment. There was another element in the battle plan that would prove to be fatal for so many. It was decided that the British troops should walk and not run towards the German trenches.
The British regular army was convinced that the new army, the territorial army, and other non-regular soldiers were not capable of conducting the high-level tactics that the British army had developed in the first 2 years of the war. So Rawlinson had to make sure that he only demanded of his soldiers what he thought they could deliver. And that meant that instead of advancing in rushes from cover to cover, as soldiers had in other battles, he was going to have them walk slowly towards the enemy. Now, that seems really stupid to modern eyes, especially with the benefit of hindsight. But remember that the artillery people have told Rawlinson that all the Germans are going to be dead anyway.
The infantry, therefore, were actually supposed to be consolidation troops rather than infiltration or penetration troops. They were therefore carrying more than 65 pounds of equipment. A number would have been carrying around about 90 pounds of equipment. Scaling ladders, barbed wire, grenades, machine guns, and that sort of thing.
It was believed that our troops could come out of our trenches, form up in no man's land and walk across. There would be nothing within the German area of their front line that could actually do them any harm. And so consequently, our men could light their pipes and walk across.
British High Command's every decision seemed to further doom the unsuspecting Tommy. So it was that in the early hours of Saturday, July the 1st, the British trenches were lined with thousands of nervous troops in full pack, bayonets fixed, each one waiting anxiously for 0 hour at 7:30. At 7:28 precisely, the huge mines under the German lines were detonated, spewing earth and rock thousands of feet into the air. But even now, the plan was beginning to go wrong. Although the explosives caused many casualties among the German ranks, the craters also created convenient new killing zones, which would soon be put to deadly use by the German machine gunners.
The mines that were used in the Battle of the Somme were designed to give us an element of surprise and also a place to give us high point looking into German trenches. The idea is then you send forward a force of infantry to take the far rim. The mine, as it explodes, raises a rim, typically between about 12 and 15 feet high. If your men can take the far rim, then they're in a position of advantage. They're looking down into the Germans.
The difficulty comes with the way in which the infantry were meant to attack the crater. They just couldn't get to the crater quickly enough. And this is largely linked into the fact that they were asked to walk up to the crater lip and then consolidate it. The Loch Nagar crater, for example, was exploded 2 minutes before 0 hour, which was 07:30. This gave the Germans plenty of time to actually consolidate, reorganise and place their machine guns around the lip of that crater and set up a very strong defensive position. At Hawthorne Ridge, that mine was actually blown at 07:20, 10 minutes before 0 hour.
These craters still survive today. They are silent and poignant reminders of how the best laid plans can go terribly awry. At 7:30, after a moment of eerie silence, whistles blew, and all along the 16-mile front, men climbed over their parapets, formed into lines as ordered, and began their slow march over no man's land towards the enemy. The German machine gunners scrambled from their bunkers and set up their deadly weapons. They opened fire and the carnage began. All along the line, British were cut down by a frenzied hail of German bullets. Within minutes, entire battalions of British troops had been all but destroyed, some having advanced only a few yards. This grainy shot with its dim figures struggling across the skyline is actual footage of that infamous attack. Primitive camera equipment and the great distance at which it was shot make it difficult to discern, but against the hillside, if you look closely, can be seen the tiny, ant-like figures of an army advancing to its doom. It's difficult to imagine the scenes of utter chaos and confusion among the British ranks as men were butchered without mercy in virtually every sector of the attack. Everything they'd been told to expect had not happened. Now they faced a storm of shot and shell from which it seemed no one could survive. It speaks volumes for the courage of the young men of Kitchener's army that at no point did the attack falter. On this day, bravery alone, however, would not be enough. Those men who did make it to the German wire found it to be practically untouched, as the reports had indicated. Even where it had been displaced, it had sprung back into huge coils that presented an impregnable barrier to progress. Although the troops struggled heroically to find a way through, many inevitably became entangled on the barbs, and hundreds of men met their end, trapped like insects on a spider's web. Only the courageous 36th Ulster Division, which had attacked the Schwaben redoubt near Thiepval at the centre of the main attack, could report any real progress. The Irishmen had, in fact, performed a remarkable feat of arms, having captured the position in the face of fierce resistance and taken more than 500 prisoners.
The Ulster Division achieved remarkable success on the first day of the Battle of the Somme. They achieved far greater territorial gains than any other division on that first day. And considering they actually had to attack and consolidate the Schwaben redoubt, which was a labyrinth of bunkers and strong points filled with German troops and machine guns, it was a remarkable achievement.
The Ulster Division on the morning of the 1st of July did things differently to many of the other divisions. Most of our divisional commanders and corps commanders had carried forward the orders of General Rawlinson and had instructed their men to walk across, forming up their lines, everything else. In the Ulster Division, they actually allowed their men to go well forward into no man's land whilst the barrage was still going on. And as the barrage lifted from the German front line, they were into it straight away. Didn't give the Germans time to get out and to prepare.
The victory, though, had been won at huge cost, and the division's grip on the position was loosening as the Germans mounted a series of determined counterattacks.
Now, once the Ulstermen get to the Schwaben redoubt, they need to be reinforced. And there was another lot of people ready to come up behind them, and they could not get forward because the Germans were concentrating every artillery round they had to spare on bombarding the Schwaben redoubt and on interdicting the flow of reinforcements to the Schwaben redoubt. So the people meant to come and relieve the Ulstermen couldn't get forward.
By midday, news of another success was filtering through to high command. The 30th Division, so ill-regarded by Rawlinson that he had very nearly taken it out of the line and replaced it with another division, had captured the village of Montauban, a village at the southern end of the British line. Not only this, they had pursued the fleeing Germans beyond the village and into the Montauban Valley, where the sight of the enemy in disarray had given the British troops genuine, if short-lived, hope that the big breakthrough had actually been achieved. Their optimism was no doubt tempered by the sight of the enormous numbers of dead and wounded on their own side. This is Montauban today. In 1916, it looked like this. For British High Command, of course, the capture of this pile of rubble constituted a victory. At least it gave the cameras an opportunity to record the first sightings of dazed, confused German prisoners. At Gommecourt, where the Third Army had made its diversionary attack, the 56th London Division had achieved all its objectives, despite sustaining appalling casualties.
At Gommecourt, when the orders came through from army level to actually walk towards the German wire, the Lieutenant Colonel of the London Scottish had a major problem with this. And so at battalion level, he countermanded these orders. And his orders were as follows. When the barrage lifts, I want every man to run as fast as he possibly can for the German wire. And just to make sure that we can run fast to the German wire, forget about carrying those 66-pound packs on your backs. So when the barrage lifted at 7:30 on the morning of the 1st of July 1916, the London Scottish were up and out of their trenches. It was a very, very short attack. We're talking about minutes for this territorial battalion to actually storm and take the entire German defence system at Gommecourt.
The 46th North Midland Division, however, had walked into the teeth of the German storm. There would be no link-up behind Gommecourt village that day.
By 08:30 hours, 1 hour into the battle, it is estimated that the British and Canadian armies alone had taken 30,000 casualties. By noon, the British and Canadian armies had taken 50,000 casualties. Throughout the day, they ended up taking 67,000 casualties, roughly. And that meant that almost everybody who was killed and wounded on the first day of the Battle of the Somme was killed or wounded before noon.
Despite the almost unremitting failures of the morning, new attacks were mounted during the afternoon. At 2:30, here at Fricourt, on the right of the Fourth Army's main attack, the men of the East Yorks Regiment rose from their trench just as their comrades had done only 7 hours earlier, and marched slowly towards the enemy over exactly the same ground. A single German machine gun raked their lines. They had travelled barely 20 yards when the order came to return to their trenches. During the assault, which lasted only 3 minutes, 123 men had been killed or wounded. This is where they rest. Although tragic scenes similar to this were played out all along the front during the afternoon of July the 1st, not all the British Army's efforts met with failure. After bitter fighting, the 7th Division captured Mametz, a village north of Montauban, the scene of the 30th Division's earlier success. In addition, the 18th Division achieved all its objectives between the two villages. These successes had been achieved at a terrible cost, and the men who had won them were entitled to ask, why was nothing being done to exploit their victories?
The situation on the Somme front at dusk was a mixture of movement and a lack of movement. In the areas where there was no movement at all, what we see are commanders desperately trying to get information as to what had happened on their front, trying to get the wounded back. In other areas, there was still some movement as the fighting continued. And of course, during the period of no light, it meant that resupplies could be brought forward, commanders could get to the front to see exactly what was going on, so that they could renew their offensive on the next day.
It wasn't until the 3rd of July that the full enormity of what had happened on day one, on the 1st of July, began to filter through to Haig's headquarters. He actually believed in the first 48 hours that it had been a resounding success. But he then, by the 4th of July, had actually realised that the whole northwestern flank of the attack had made very, very little progress indeed.
On the first day of the Battle of the Somme, 6 German divisions had held off 18 Allied divisions and given up approximately no territory.
The Battle of the Somme dragged on until November, when the snows came to call a halt to the carnage.
The remaining 4 months of the Battle of the Somme are often forgotten. Many people actually perceive the Battle of the Somme to be the first day. And I think that's understandable with 60,000 casualties having been sustained. But we must remember that actually the battle continues into mid-November. The British suffer over 420,000 casualties, the Germans over 600,000. There was still an awful lot of fighting still to be done.
There is a famous line that the Battle of the Somme was oriented towards sacrificing thousands of British lives in an effort to move Douglas Haig's drinks cabinet closer to Berlin by 1 yard. And that's pretty much what the progress of the Battle of the Somme is all about.
So what we have in the Somme is a grinding attritional struggle which becomes very, very similar to the Battle of Verdun, which incidentally is still going on to the south. And eventually the Somme battle is closed down as the weather deteriorates in November.
The British were approximately 7 miles further on, although the ground, which they could now call their own, was so shattered by the fighting it was beyond use. It is the events of that first terrible day of the battle, however, which give the Somme its special place in British military history. As the sun set on Saturday, July the 1st, 1916, Britain had lost the flower of its youth, swept away by a combination of rank bad planning and German bullets.
The night of the 1st to 2nd of July was absolutely indescribable. There were men screaming, the men crying for water. It was like a scene from hell along much of that front.
Popular history has condemned Douglas Haig alone for the disaster on the Somme. And even with the benefit of hindsight, his constant repetition of failed tactics and obvious lack of faith in his untried troops is impossible to excuse. Surely, though, the blame must fall at least in part upon the other senior officers who planned the offensive. Rawlinson, in particular, was responsible for some of the attack's most disastrous aspects.
By the end of July the 1st, neither Haig nor Rawlinson had actually achieved what they hoped to achieve, and perhaps that is a result of a compromise plan, a plan that didn't really satisfy the desires of either men. Haig didn't really get a plan backed by Rawlinson that would see a massive breakthrough. Rawlinson didn't really get the plan that he wanted, a bite-and-hold type operation in which slow but sure progress would be made.
Nothing was expected strategically and nothing was gained strategically at the Battle of the Somme. It was a tactical battle that went on for 140 days, killed a lot of people, and produced almost no results.
Ultimately, perhaps, the truth was that the general who would have fought the war differently had not been born. All of which made no difference to the men of Kitchener's army who stood in the line of fire on that fateful July morning, about to make the supreme sacrifice. Although they could never have known it, their own generals had sealed their fate.